our Peetlam Marae. Peetlam Marae is one of the recent, or the recent most advanced in MRI. Now, before starting off with Peetlam Marae, everybody has their own apprehensions regarding the safety of MRI for the fetus. Now, these are excerpts from the latest journals. Okay. Although the deleterious effects of MRI has not been documented, okay, neither has the safety been established. Now it is a negative talk, but there have been no ill effects demonstrated so far with MRI. Now the primary concern is the one is the sound, because with an MRI if you have seen, there will be a lot of sound. The one is there going to be any hearing damage to the fetus because of the loud noise? Even adults are scared of the noise. Will it not affect the fetus or not? That is the primary concern. The two is that this involves radio frequency waves. Now this will create some heat. Now is this heat going to cause any teratogenic effects? These are the two primary concerns. But according to the latest research publications, so far none has been documented. Now, what are the current recommendations? It is safe to do MRI in second and third trimester. It is safe, it is documented that it is safe to do MRI in second and third trimester. If possible, please delay the MRI to second and third trimester. But if it is inevitable, wherein you want to actually assess the placenta and the other structures, annexal structures, you can do an MRI in the first trimester, provided it is warranted. Now, according to the ACR is the American College of Radiology. Now, they have issued a white paper as to the indications for MRI. Could the information be obtained by ultrasound itself? If you can get the information by ultrasound itself, you need not go in for an MRI. Now, because of doing the MRI and the result of the MRI, is it going to change the plan of action? If it is, yes, then it is indication for MRI. Can the study be postponed till after the pregnancy? If you can postpone it till after the pregnancy, well and good, please postpone the MRI. And in a pregnant patient, there is no role for any intravenous contrast media. We will not give iodine-based or gadolinium-based. Gadolinium-based is what we use in MRI. If we are doing a CT also, there is no role of intravenous contrast media because it will bypass the placenta into the fetus. And the deleterious effects of the intravenous gadolinium or the contrast iodine is not known. So these are, I'm sure this is what most of us are scared about. The physicians, definitely physicians are scared about the ill effects of MRI. Now, with regards to the patient positioning, patient is usually supine, or if she is very uncomfortable, patient can be positioned in the left lateral decubitus position. And the patient's head is usually outside the machine, so therefore the claustrophobia effect is always very, very less. And also the patient, since the patient's head is outside, they can always have an accompanying patient giving her a small talk. Now, what are the indications for MRI, fetal MRI? One is confirmation of anomalies which are detected on ultrasound. And two, evaluation of sonographically upper diagnosis. I'll give you an example of the following slides. Two is in cases of oligohydramnios, wherein there is very less glycogen and ultrasound needs a lot of water to be around. In those cases, again, to evaluate the fetus for anomalies, MRI is useful. In cases of prematurity, when you are expecting a premature labor, you can actually assess the fetal lung volume fetal lung volume with the fetal MRI. Of course, ultrasound also can do it, but this is less user dependent and this is more accurate. Now, what are the indications? I'm going to show a lot of examples with what are the current indications for fetal MRI. The commonest indication or the commonest reference for ventricular MRI is usually ventriculomegaly. Now, what is ventriculomegaly? This is an axial section of the brain showing the both the lateral ventricles. When the diameter of lateral ventricles is more than 10 millimeters, we call it ventriculomegaly. Therefore, confirmation of the ventriculomegaly, one. Two, to identify the cause of ventriculomegaly. Most often, the sonologist is not able to identify the cause of ventriculomegaly, so then, therefore, you have been used and referred for a fetal MRI. Other anomalies like corpuscular agenesis. Corpusculosum is a very, very thin and small structure which can be missed on MRI. There are indirect signs for corpuscular agenesis, but then to confirm the actual absence of corpusculosum, MRI is useful, and you can see the big picture showing the deep beta hemispheric fissure. Other anomalies like of the cerebrum, like schizencephaly, lissencephaly, or the actual brain development of the sulcations and the gyrations, it is very well depicted on MRI. Ultrasound will not show the schizencephalic defects or the lissencephalic defects. Evaluation of the posterior fossa. Posterior fossa, since there is a bone covering the posterior fossa, there is always a little ambiguity with the visual region of posterior fossa with ultrasound. In those cases, MRI is very, very useful. Here you can see a large posterior fossa cyst, which turned out to be a Dandy Walker malformation. This is another slide showing inferior tonsillar herniation into the spinal canal with an associated myelomeningocele, which is characteristic of GRE2 malformation. Again, for confirmation of spinal anomalies and for complex anomalies, MRI is the modality of choice. Preoperative evaluation of congenital spinal anomalies, again MRI is very, very useful. We can actually measure the diameter of the spinal defect, what are the contents of the myelomeningocele or the posterior bulge is very, very, MRI can actually depict, is it only meningocele or is there associated spinal cord within, is there any other anomalies elsewhere, again MRI is very, very useful in those conditions. Again, evaluation of sacrococcygeal masses. Again, here you can see a large sacrococcygeal teratoma, and also it also helps in classifying the sacrococcygeal teratoma with regards to the position and to the extent. Now, coming to the neck, this is a large cystic teratoma in the neck, and also you can see a large cystic swelling in the posterior aspect of the thing, called this is nothing but a cystic hygroma. Cystic hygroma is nothing but a lymphatic malformation in the posterior aspect of the thing. Now coming to the chest. Chest is a blind area for sonologists because of the lack of imaging finds or because of the lack of characteristic features of the lung. In cases of cystic CCAMs or the cystic adenomatous malformations, there's a large cyst. I call it a cyst because it is appearing similar to the CSF signal intensity, the circuitovator sequence. Again, this is a congenital cystic adenomatoid malformations. In cases of bronchopulmonary sequestration, this is the normal lung. This is the bronchopulmonary sequestration. We can actually demonstrate the feeding artery and the draining vein arising from the systemic circulation. In evaluation of congenital diaphragmatic hernias, in these cases, MRI is very, very useful. One is because to confirm the diaphragmatic hernia, and two, to assess the volume of the remaining lung. In cases of abdomen, is mainly used for evaluating the renal urogenital system to know exactly where the obstruction is. This is a case of a PUJ, but whereas here you see a large hydronephrosis and hydrouretronephrosis. Again, this is a case of PUJ, this is a case of a posterior urethral valve diagnosed in utero. again, with bowel anomalies, like, do patients cyst? MRI is very, very useful if it goes over ultrasound. These are the indications for MRI. And of course, I also mentioned about the safety of MRI also. Need our help.
Anatomical variations. Can you make out functional abnormality? For example, any paraplegia, neurovascular disease.
There are, as of now,
that is the most important.
Functional analysis is very important, but the recent data says that we can pick up hypoxic insults of the brain in utero itself. If there is a case of a fetal distress or maternal distress, you can actually pick up the hypoxic insult in the brain in utero itself. You need not wait for the baby to come out and then evaluate with MRI for such conditions. That is what the current status is. Functional analysis with regards to the heart valves or the heart, it hasn't come up to that level as yet.
Sir, can functional MRI be performed in the second and third trimester?
No, sir. Functional MRI is a very, very programmed study, sir, wherein both the subject should also cooperate. The subject should do what we ask the subject to do. So in this, we cannot tell the fetus, even a baby won't listen to this one. And it's not programmed. Functional MRI is a programmed MRI. So it's not. We cannot program the child to do certain things.
Can you do PET, CT, positron emission tomography?
No, sir. No, sir. Again, that is completely out because of the radiation.
What is the cost? How many centers in the city there?
Every 1.5 Tesla MRI in the city will be able to do a fetal MRI. The cost would be around it's the same as normal, except that it is very time consuming. Sir. The thing is, the baby may move, so you'll have to take the baby out of the patient out of the MRI scanner, make her wait for the baby to actually ask the baby to mother to eat, come back. So it is time consuming. Cost-wise, so they may charge extra for that thing, but again, it's nothing different.
I just want to ask two questions. One is...
It's not working.
One is, I want to know where you can say definitely this pregnant woman needs an MRI, or probably ultrasound is enough, we don't need an MRI. Number one question. Number two, recently I had two patients which were reported as congenital cystic adenomatosis and also pulmonary sequestration. Okay, so what they said is probably pulmonary sequestration, and she also went for MRI. They also said feeding artery is pulmonary artery, and then follow up. Okay, this patient is asking me whether I need to have a termination. I asked the pediatrician, she says she doesn't know. Of course, I cannot say. And then what do you say for this? What I should counsel for the patient? She is definitely asking. I told her probably there will be a respiratory infection in future, something like this, because there is nothing definitely given. So by increasing and asking her to spend 10,000 rupees for MRI, and finally we are not able to give anything definite. So can you say something?
Bronchopulmonary sequestration is not a lethal anomaly.
Yeah, exactly.
It's not lethal normally, so therefore the patient can continue with the pregnancy.
Sir, that's what I told them, but she's asking me to give guarantee that the baby will be completely alright.
You cannot say completely alright, but it is not an indication for the correct indication for MRI. There is this white paper which is thing. This is actually the white paper. If you can fulfill this criteria, if the finding can be got on ultrasound itself, then we need not go for a MRI. But then there are anomalies which can be better confirmed with the current generation of learned people, they want proper documentation. They are better in the net, so they want proper documentation by MRI itself. Half the anomalies are already confirmed on ultrasound. We come for this again, second confirmation with MRI. So that is, this is one is the patient's need and the patient's want. Next is by actually saying, okay, patient has some anomaly, is it going to change the line of management? For example, corpuscular diagenesis is compatible with life, people will go on normally throughout their life. So in those patients, if you want to spend 10,000 rupees extra, if the patient is affordable, yes. If the patient is not affordable, in case of corpuscular diagenesis, it is not needed. But to see for associated anomalies, is there any other anomaly elsewhere MRI is useful? If the study can be prolonged, some other after, for example, limb defects, if it can be prolonged, yes, we can wait for the baby to come out and then do it, for example, CDHN.
What about trachea?
We can demonstrate the link between the trachea and the esophagus, and if but then it's all filled with water. So again, ultrasound will score over that, of course.
Can you clarify the third point? Could the study be postponed until the patient is no longer pregnant? What do you mean by that?
For example, if you want to evaluate the baby, for example, CDH, sir. Supposing CDH, CDH, I mean the hip dysplasias or any limb defects like is it going to actually give you any importance to the line of management? I'm sure we can all wait for the baby to deliver and then evaluate the baby further. One more is, I think this pertains more to MRI of the mother.
Yeah, that's
right. It's more to MRI of the mother.
We are talking about fetal monitoring.
I mean, fetal monitoring, that's the thing, but then this is also, the patient is in the MRI machine. In fetal MRI or brain MRI is all in the same machine, so this, whether we have been doing of MRI for mother's brain, for example, she has got amnesia or insomnia, sleeplessness, we can actually postpone it to after the pregnancy.